What is up, my dudes? We're back again with another video, and today we're going to be talking about why the Orioles were so good this year. Without Trey Mancini and John Means, the Orioles weren't sure who was going to step up, with Trey Mancini being out for the year and John Means not able to start the season on time. Through August, the Orioles were 15-19, which on paper doesn't look good for any team, but for the Orioles, that's impressive. That is dominance. Many people thought 15 wins was a good estimate of wins the Orioles would have for the entire season. The Orioles finished with a 25-35 record, and while this isn't amazing, once again, this is leaps and bounds better than their 2019 season. Let's go over what contributed to the Orioles' success and progress in 2020. Hanser Alberto was good, but not quite as good as last year. But there were so many other offensive producers in this lineup that made up for Hanser Alberto not being his over 300 average self that he normally is. He wasn't bad by any means, but he certainly had his second half struggles, like a lot of people on this list. Anthony Santander finished the season with an 890 OPS and drove in 32 runs in 37 games. He also won the Orioles MVP award, which I felt like was a no-brainer considering that while he was on the team, the Orioles did well. And as soon as he was injured, the Orioles fell off in the playoff race.
Looking at my drip, looking at your drip. Whoa, mommy, look at me. Oh, I'm killing it. Whoa, swinging side to side and I'm killing that.
Ronaldo Nunez was surprisingly buried in the Orioles' offense. Not for lack of production, though. He put up a solid 816 OPS, but per usual, his power came and went as he put up 12 home runs. Pedro Severino, through the first half of the season, was the undisputed all-star catcher for the American League that we hoped he would turn out to be. But then, in the second half of the season, his bat went completely silent, and he ended the season with a 710 OPS and a 250 average. Chance Sisko had a similar season to Pedro Severino, having a great first half, but very below average second half. Rio Ruiz looked much improved to start the season, but finished with a 222 average. And another player that we're going to add to this list of having very inconsistent second half, DJ Stewart, for that weak stretch when he had 6 home runs and looked like Barry Bonds. But then, to no one's surprise, he fell back to earth. Cesar Valdez was one of my favorite players to watch this season. He's got the nastiest pitch I've ever seen. He mixes up the tempo of his delivery, sometimes quick pitching, and he's able to throw off hitters using only 2 pitches. He racked up a 1.26 ERA and a 0.7 whip. Also, he's 35 years old. This guy is just getting started.
See a major league pitch for the first time against Colton Brewer. and it's low and away. Ryan Mountcastle walks to lead off the second.
Ryan Mountcastle, the former first round pick, ready for a 3-2. And he takes it high, ball four. So the first hit will wait, but Ryan Mountcastle is on base twice with a couple of walks in his big league debut.
The Orioles Rookie of the Year award has to go to Ryan Mountcastle. Mountcastle became a middle of the order bat by the end of the season and put up a .333 average, 23 RBIs, and an .878 OPS through 126 at bats. Jose Iglesias was signed in the offseason after coming off a pretty good season with the Reds. He's always been one of the best shortstops in the league defensively, but his offense has always been subpar at best. But this year, he transformed himself into a three-hole hitter. I don't even know where this came from. He hit 17 doubles. He also had an insane .956 OPS despite having only three home runs. I don't think I've ever seen such a weird but amazing offensive season quite like Jose Iglesias' of 2020. I'm excited for the future of the Baltimore Orioles, and I hope you guys are too. Thank you guys for watching. We'll see you guys in the next video. Later. I'm not-